Good afternoon, I'm Denise Dinsai, and here are the stories that made it to ANC's rundown. The Philippine province of Batanes under storm signal number 2 due to Typhoon Henry. An increase in local rice prices seen next month. And U.S. President Joe Biden calls on Americans to resist threats to democracy as he blames his predecessor for the rise of extremism in Washington. Welcome to the program. Storm signal number 2 up over the Philippine province of Batanes due to Typhoon Henry. Strong winds along with moderate to at times intense rains are being experienced there. Classes and government work have been suspended. The local government of Batanes is on alert for possible flooding and landslides.
Medyo malakas ang ulan ngayon. Malalaki na rin ang alon sa aming mga karagatan. Hindi kami nagpapakampante. Sa kasalukuyan, wala pa namang naiulat na mga nasirang tahanan, ari-arian o mga infrastruktura.
Typhoon Henry continues to weaken as it moves over the Philippine Sea. Aside from Batanes, signal number 1 is also up over the Babuyan Islands and the northeastern portion of mainland Cagayan. Moderate to heavy rains are expected over those areas. Henry is forecast to exit the Philippines Saturday evening or Sunday morning. The Philippine Disaster Management Agency also on alert for Typhoon Henry. The National Disaster Risk Reduction and Management Council says areas in the path of the storm have been reminded to make the necessary preparations. It adds relief assistance and standby funds are readily available for those who may be affected by the typhoon.
Since August 31, ay tuloy-tuloy yung ating pagbigay ng mga abiso sa mga LGUs. And so far, maganda naman ang mga reports na natatanggap natin. Lahat po ay nakahanda, lahat po ay nag-anticipate dito sa epekto ng bagyo. As far as major infrastructures, wala po tayong nakikita ng major damage dito kasi medyo malayo siya. So kasi ang threat lang talaga dito ay yung malakas na hangin, yung dagat, no, maalon, and of course yung pag-ulan doon sa areas na yan. But tingnan pa rin natin yung epekto ng habagat na pwedeng dalhin nitong Henry, lalo na sa regions 1 and Carr. So yun po, babantayan natin yan.
A landslide in Ifugao leaves at least one person dead. The landslide happened Thursday following heavy rains caused by Typhoon Henry. Authorities say the 37-year-old man was staying at the house of his brother when the incident happened. The mayor of Masantol in Pampanga seeking the help of the national government to deal with severe flooding. 22 out of 26 villages there remain flooded. 19 out of the town's 28 schools also inundated.
We're appealing to the national government to put us under the magnifying glass and silipin po ang bayan ng Masantol and to consider us as one of the towns in the country na talagang nangangailangan po ng national government agents intervention. And we've asked them, we've appealed to them na kung pwede, huwag po nating i-risk ang ating mga educators, huwag po nating i-risk ang ating mga mag-aaral. Kung pwede, let's shift back to blended learning. Huwag po nating pilitin yung face-to-face kung talagang hindi kailangan at kung talagang nasa peligro po ang ating mga mag-aaral at mga educators.
Turning now to the sugar importation mess, Senator Rizzo Ontiveros says the continued absence of Executive Secretary Vic Rodriguez in their probe sets a dangerous precedent. Ontiveros fears this may embolden other officials of the executive branch to snub future Senate hearings.
I join my minority leader, Senator Coco, that E.S. Rodriguez must face the committee. Bakit siya bibigyan ng exemption? No? First 100 days pa lang, may excuse letter na kaagad. I mean, Anong kinatatakutan niya? What information is he hiding? What information doesn't he want the public to know? I want to find out from him what his take is on the conflicting stories about how the president found out about the draft sugar order number 4. Is it true that the president with the ES only found out about it on the SRA website? Or, as the former SRA officials say, that they personally, Yusek Sebastian in particular, personally informed the president about the sugar order.
Senator Ontiveros adds, someone in Malacañang must be held accountable.
Buck should stop in Malacañang because the executive secretary was involved at certain points of the process, but unfortunately wouldn't allow the Blue Ribbon to complete the picture. Andito tayo sa gitna ng isang food crisis. Economists warn us not to allow it to degenerate into a food catastrophe. The president has to be better served by his executive secretary or by his cabinet, by the office of the ES getting its act together.
Senator Cynthia Villar wants heads to roll over what she says is the poor performance of agriculture-related agencies. That's after she learned key programs given to them are either on a snail pace mode or are not progressing at all. Among those at the receiving end of Villar's wrath, Philippine Coconut Authority Administrator Benjamin Madrigal. At a Senate hearing Thursday, Villar called out Madrigal for failing to distribute benefits of farmers under the Coconut Farmers and Industry Trust Fund Act more than a year after the law was approved.
Ikaw ang head ng PCA, hindi ba responsibility mo na ma-implement yan? Eh di tawagan mo ng tawagan kung ayaw nilang mag-request, ikaw ang mag-follow up. Bakit ka mag-wash ng hand dyan? Eh ikaw ang head ng PCA. Kung hindi mo kayang gawin yan, di mag-resign ka.
I will, Madam Chair.
Ang hirap sa inyo. Gusto niyo position, ayaw niyo magtrabaho.
The heads of other agencies such as the Bureau of Soils and Water Management and the Philippine Center for Post-Harvest Development and Mechanization also got a tongue-lashing from Senator Villar. That's as the agencies also failed to utilize funds meant to help local farmers. Back with more news, an agriculture group warns local rice prices may increase next month. That's if government fails to distribute the 8 billion peso subsidy to around 1.6 million farmers in the first week of September. Some groups say the possible price increase is meant to help rice farmers cover production costs in the absence of the subsidy from government.
4 to 5 pesos yun ang nakita natin. From 38 to 43, ganon, 43 per kilo. So yun ang mangyayari kung hindi naibigay yung ayuda. Malaking effect yan sa ating consumer. So lalo na kung makita natin yung world market price ng bigas sa other countries, mataas din. Tumaas din yung presyo ng imported.
From about 1,000 pesos per bag ng urea, sumipa siya ng over 3,000 bags, 3,000 pesos per bag. No? And normally, you would use about 4 to 6 bags of fertilizer per hectare. No? So, ang estimate namin, tumaas yung cost of production nila just from fertilizer cost ng mga 10 to 15,000 pesos per hectare. No. Wala pa din yung increase sa fuel, pati yung labor cost tumaas.
The Agriculture Department is looking into the price projection.
Yung mga ganyan pong movement ng agricultural inputs definitely affects our farm gate price. So ang titinitingnan po natin ngayon is yung palay price po, yung paggalaw nun ng ating commodity.
Government agencies and telco firms take action following the proliferation of text scams containing the full names of recipients. We have more from Jackie Pascual.
Text scams have become personalized, with many complaining of receiving text messages offering work or money and this time with their names included in the message.
Yung mismo yung pangalan ko, Sir Alex, yun, nanalo ka ng 100,000.
Nagtataka lang po ako bakit nagtetext sila ng ganun. Kasi nga, hindi pa po ba nila naiisip na mahirap na nga po yung mga tao. Nagkaroon na nga po ng pandemya, tapos manggaganon pa sila.
Even Supreme Court Senior Associate Justice Marvick Leonin expresses concern and calls the scam very dangerous. He suspects data may have been leaked or sold. The National Telecommunications Commission is alarmed by the rising number of text scams, especially where personal details are included in the message.
Kanilang style ngayon is mapapanggap na kakilala kasi may pangalan na eh. So kung ikaw naman ay kakilala ko nito, so maniniwala ka ngayon. So click dito, click doon. That's the problem. Kasi scam 'yun.
Cabarrios believes the personal information were collected from social media sites, messaging apps, and even from forms where people usually fill up information. A digital advocacy group also says private companies and government agencies may have been exposed to data breach, resulting in the spread of people's personal information. Senator Bong Revilla is calling on NTC to beef up measures against tech scam, saying a criminal syndicate may be behind it. The NTC admits it would be difficult to identify the perpetrators as it is hard to track text messages. NTC has ordered telcos to issue text warnings to its subscribers as it also urges telcos to block numbers from scammers.
Wag na wag ka kagat, no? I-block, i-delete yung message at i-report. Pagka may link na pinapapunta ka, wag na wag gagawin yun.
Cabarrios also supports the proposed SIM card registration bill to help track those who send text scams. Globe says it has blocked 784 million scam and spam messages and has deactivated 14,000 numbers and blacklisted about 9,000 phone numbers. PLDT Smart also says it is also strengthening its cybersecurity efforts to protect subscribers. The public is urged to report text scams to the Cybercrime Investigation and Coordinating Center. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
The National Privacy Commission also investigating the proliferation of spam text messages. Privacy Commissioner John Henry Naga says they are coordinating with telco providers as well as the NTC to gather more information. Naga also urged Filipinos to remain vigilant in protecting their personal data. Meanwhile, the Philippine Cybercrime Investigation and Coordinating Center is taking its cues from other countries that are experiencing similar problems.
We are on our toes here, and we are not just hitting it on the side of regulation, because you just keep on regulating, you are pressing on the private sector, and then para ka nag-aabang ng mga kaso, and it's not good. This is not only purely local in nature. Yeah. All the countries are experiencing the same thing. Okay, the same thing. And we're trying to configure how we're going to be doing the cross-border digital data that will be appreciated by other countries so that we can figure out how we're going to go about this.
We're taking a quick break. Coming up, U.S. President Joe Biden launches a scathing attack against his predecessor, Donald Trump. More on that when we come back. Stay with ANC's Rundown. Welcome back. Groups of health workers urge President Marcos to work on releasing their benefits before pushing for a salary hike. Marcos has vowed to fix the pay disparity between nurses in private and public hospitals. But groups point out, while they're in favor of a salary increase, more than half of health workers in the country have yet to receive their COVID allowances. They also urge government to probe the slow distribution of benefits.
Ngayon po, nagbigay po sila ng pang January lang po na allowance. So, nag-lapse na po yung batas, nag-expired na po. Yun na nga po ang pinagtataka po namin dito kasi hindi meron pong discrimination. Kaya nga po doon sa aming mga kahilingan, i-liquidate, imbestigahan yung sistema po ng pagbibigay ng mga ayuda sa lahat ng mga health workers.
sa kabuuan siguro, almost mga 60% ng mga health workers pa rin ang hindi po nakakatanggap. Kaya malungkot at demoralized yung ating mga health workers. Kahapon naglabas din ang DPM, ang sabi nila, ang DOS may kasalanan nito dahil maraming beses na sinuratan sila na pag-submit na ng mga required documents. Pero hanggang sa kasalukuyan ay hindi pa rin ito nagagawa ng Department of Health, kaya hindi rin sila nagre-release. Kaya nakakalungkot ako, dalawang ahensya nagbabangayan at ang apektado dito yung ating mga health workers.
The Budget Department has said it is ready to release the requested funding for COVID allowance of health workers. But it says the health department must first address deficiencies in its request. The Migrant Workers Department reviewing the push of President Marcos to open more slots for the deployment of Filipino nurses abroad. The agency says it is willing to help nurses who want to work in other countries.
It's an aspiration, of course, na kung pwede, wag na nating i-deploy ang ating mga workers. But at the same time, you also have to take a look at it, Ms. Rica, na we should not put a restraint on our workers seeking a livelihood that will provide them an income that will make the lives of their family better than where it is now.
A 7,500 deployment cap for healthcare workers going abroad remains in effect. But officials say the cap is not yet breached as the COVID situation in other countries improves. One of the bus operators in government's free ride program says it's unfortunate no funds were allotted for it next year. Metrolink Corporation says the program benefited bus operators because they were assured of regular income for the duration of the project. It adds the payment scheme of government to operators has improved.
On our end, especially for operators, it's a good thing kasi hindi po kami mamumroblema sa pasada. It's a very good program naman po. Ang nagiging issue lang po kasi po yung sa delay ng bayad. Right now po yung payment scheme po, medyo may delay po siya. But they worked on it. They worked on it naman po. So dati po ang delay po nasa more than a month.
Mm-hmm.
But recently, they've been active naman po in paying us faster.
But for one group, some commuters are just being forced to avail government's free ride program to save money, not because it's convenient for them.
We have to stand by our own. Kailangan lang, very well regulated. At isa po, napakahirap po noong pagsakay dyan. Hirap na hirap ang karamihan sa kanila. Kaya nga lang, marami sa ating mga kababayan, syempre, naghahari muna po sa libreng sakay dahil hindi naman po na-consider yung pagtaas ng pasahe dun sa ating in-approve na minimum wage. Kaya nagtsatsaga po sila dyan, pero oras na po mawala ang libreng sakay dyan. I'm sure mas gugustuhin po nila na sumakay dun na sa mga talagang regular route.
News overseas, U.S. President Joe Biden urges Americans to reject extremism ahead of the midterm elections in November. In a primetime address Thursday evening, Biden slammed his predecessor Donald Trump and his loyal followers for promoting an extremist ideology that threatens democracy. Biden's remarks come as he steps up efforts to help Democrats hang on to control in Congress with the midterm polls just 2 months away. He's also looking to boost his stakes for his own 2024 re-election bid.
MAGA Republicans do not respect the Constitution. They do not believe in the rule of law. They do not recognize the will of the people. They refuse to accept the results of a free election. MAGA forces are determined to take this country backwards. Backwards to an America where there is no right to choose, no right to privacy, no right to contraception, no right to marry who you love. They promote authoritarian leaders and they fan the flames of political violence that are a threat to our personal rights to the pursuit of justice, to the rule of law, to the very soul of this country.
A retired New York policeman sentenced to 10 years in prison for joining the U.S. Capitol riot in January 2021. That's the stiffest punishment yet for those who took part in the assault. Thomas Webster was said to have wrestled one officer to the ground, while others in the mob kicked the police, leaving him with multiple injuries. Violence ensued at the U.S. Capitol early last year after supporters of then-President Donald Trump stormed Congress in a bid to thwart the certification of Joe Biden's election victory. United Nations Chief Antonio Guterres urges China to implement recommendations made in the report of its Human Rights Office alleging serious violations in the Xinjiang region. The UN spokesperson said Guterres was concerned by what he read in the report. That report found torture allegations against Uyghurs and other Muslim minorities in Xinjiang credible.
That human rights must be respected and that the Uyghur community needs to be respected and made feel it belongs to the country as a whole without discrimination. The Secretary General very much hopes that the government of China will take on board the recommendations put forward in the assessment by the High Commissioner for Human Rights.
But Beijing slammed the report, calling it a tool manufactured by the West in an attempt to control China. China has repeatedly rejected claims it detained more than 1 million Muslims in Xinjiang. Switching gears now, NASA gears up for its second attempt to launch the Artemis moon rocket. A September 3 launch is set at the Kennedy Space Center in Florida. Liftoff is set at 2:17 p.m. Florida time. But NASA says there's no guarantee if it would push through. An engine issue forced NASA to scrub the test flight of its powerful new rocket Monday, dealing a setback to its plan to send humans back to the moon and eventually to Mars. And before we go, after years of clamor, it's finally happening. Twitter is internally testing an edit button, and it will soon be expanded, but only to paying subscribers. Twitter gave details of the planned edit tweet feature in a blog post. Users will be able to edit their tweet for a few times within 30 minutes of posting. There will also be a linked edit history for modified tweets. Once rolled out, the edit button would be the biggest shift in Twitter since 2017, when it increased the character limit from 140 to 280. And that's the rundown. I'm Denise Dinsai. Thank you so much for watching. Subscribe to the ANC YouTube channel, like us on Facebook, and follow us on Twitter. Stay safe and stay with ANC.